Planning Board meeting will come to order, please. Welcome. It is September 19th, and this is the September meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. Do I hear a motion to waive the reading of the last minutes?
So.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Are there any additions or corrections to the August minutes?
And one question. Did we receive a letter from George Marcus regarding the right-of-way? Was it in our packet?
I think we received a letter from George Marcus, and I acknowledged it several months ago. But I do have a new letter that came in late from George Marcus. This is a second letter dated September 18th regarding the Highlands.
But this one referred to a July 24th letter.
I think we acknowledged that.
We acknowledged that. Okay, I just don't remember seeing. That's possible. Okay.
Any other comments about the minutes? Do I hear a motion to accept the August minutes?
So moved.
A second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Under old business, Meadowview, a six-lot major subdivision, is the next topic. Since I have been a friend of one of the abutters, I decided that I could be construed or perceived that I was biased. So I will step down from the chair and ask Ivan Most to take over, please.
Okay.
Thanks, Ivan.
Okay, I think we're now down one member, so I will appoint, I think it's an order of seniority, is it? Steve Etze or Judy? Judy. Judy, you would be Judy Wyman as a voting member on this issue. Okay. Meadowview subdivision, is there a representative present? Could you please identify yourself? And
I'm Wayne Johnson, one of the general partners of Meadowview, and I have here Ken Tubbs, the other general partner, and our consultants, Lisa Cowan and John Mitchell of Mitchell & Associates.
Okay. If I remember correctly, by reviewing our minutes, at the end of our session, which we tabled the application at last time, there were a few issues left outstanding. One concerned some an issue related to the easement, which I hope we'll discuss tonight, and the other related to some buffering, where we received some letters on that issue. Were there any other open items that we are to discuss tonight?
I think the other items perhaps weren't open to deal with the letter of credit, issues of that nature.
So if we could confine ourselves to the items remaining, that would probably be the most expeditious way to deal with this tonight.
Yeah. Well, Mr. Chairman, the other aspect is we really have two things to deal with. One is to determine application completeness, mm-hmm. and then if the board so deems that the application to be complete, then to act upon the application substance.
Right. Could we address the items then that were left open from the last meeting?
Yes. Would you want me to address those, or would you prefer to ask questions about them?
Why don't you address them, and then we may still have some questions.
Subsequent to the last meeting, we met with the Conservation Commission and walked the site, mm-hmm. along with Town Manager Mike McGovern. And in walking the site, it was determined that the land along this edge was appropriate, was a good site. But when we reached the back of the portion of the property which abutted Canterbury, there were a considerable amount of wetland on the Canterbury side, and the Conservation Commission requested that we include the piece along this portion because it was high land, and even during the wet season when the streams of the wetlands might rise, this would provide an opportunity for the public to walk along here, meet here, and as you recall from previous meetings, hopefully someday this would tie in with the Hobstone easement. I think, from my own personal perspective, when we finally got out there and realized that our small project played an important part in the Cape Greenbelt, and as you looked at the property, I think you could hardly fail to get excited about what this might mean for the future. So we're pleased. I think the process has worked with the Conservation Commission. And with regard, perhaps I should stop and opening it up to any questions on that issue first before I go on to another.
Okay. Are there any questions from the board on the issue of the easement, which has gone through a number of changes to this point in time?
So that walkers along there would have relatively dry feet?
Yes, that's true. There are two areas that Ken Tubbs has located that would require some crossing of a wetland. We were able to cross it. There were rudimentary bridges, logs having been put across perhaps by people in the past, and the Conservation Commission did request that before the project was finished that a couple of rudimentary bridges be established there. It would be my opinion that that wouldn't be difficult for us to do, but before we would do that, we would approach the Department of Environmental Protection to, one, determine whether a wetlands permit was required or whether there should be a letter of non-jurisdiction issued. And we would be willing to do that so that we complied with their regulations and also contact the Army Corps of Engineers. That's consistent with the policies that Ken and I have used before.
Okay, I think I think the issue here is if there are any other agencies such as the Army Corps of Engineers that would require, because of this bridge situation, that they would all be contacted. Okay.
We would do that.
All right. Anything else about this? What was the issue of wording? Was that applied to this wording change?
There is one issue regarding the wording of the easement itself, and that's something that has been, I believe, worked out, but still the discussions between the attorneys, they've come to an agreement in terms of the actual language. It's there, but I think to play it safe, it might make sense to have Tom Leahy look it over one more time with the versions that were granted to us, and that's something that we could, that the board could make as a condition of approval, if it so wished.
And this was modeled after, Hobstone or Stonegate?
It was actually a review of a combination of them, and in reviewing the easements and the language that we developed, Tom Leahy suggested that perhaps the town did not want to ensure the safety and the rights of all public citizens and give a cause of action to the developer and the homeowners. It was accepted, however, that our concerns with regard to the cleanliness of the site and those kinds of things would remain in the document, and that should be enough protection, and I think we agree with that. I think an effective compromise has been reached.
Okay. Any other questions on this issue of the easement? Okay, maybe we can move to the issue of buffering.
Well, with the issue of buffering, because we have numerous letters coming to the planning board with regard to that issue, I want to be very careful in my wording because there have been some question about representation. To the best of my knowledge, we do not have any major concerns about buffering with the abutters, with the exception of Mr. Edward Drynan and Mr. Michael Drynan, who are two separate entities, and we've been reminded of that. We have not reached agreement with those two gentlemen. What we did, and I would like to ask Lisa Cowan to come up and show the buffering that we did add after we reviewed the site in hopes of adding something in addition to what we had presented the last time and perhaps trying to satisfy the board of our good faith intentions. Lisa, would you describe that, please?
Lisa Cowan with Mitchell & Associates. The buffering that was added on the site that consists of 7 white pines, 6 to 8 feet high, so that was we had two different sizes of pines going on in the project, so that was the larger size. A total of, I think, 3 additional ones were added adjacent to Ed Drynan's property. 2 were added that would affect Mike Drynan's property along his border, and, no, I'm sorry, I think four were added on his Drynan's property, excuse me. Two were added on along the border of Mike Drynan's property, and one was added along the border of the Mullen property, so that's a total of seven that were added to the plan.
How far apart are you in terms of your discussions with these individuals, in terms of what they wanted?
The trees are about 15 feet apart right now.
No, that's not what I meant. In your discussions of numbers, how far apart are you?
I think Mr. Drynan, yeah, I was...
I'm not sure we're going to have a meeting of the minds. There is a question as to whether Mr. Drynan requested a gift of land for some sort of damages, and in addition to that gift of land from the developers, additional buffering. So we have additional questions, and I think the problem has arisen over these kind of issues.
Okay. Any questions from the board?
We received a letter in our packet that you perhaps are aware of from Walden Randall, who's recently purchased property abutting your subdivision. Have you talked with her or discussed the buffering at all with her?
I'm going to let Mr. Tubbs answer those questions.
I met with Mrs. Randall about 6 weeks ago. Showed her the overall plan, the overall subdivision plan, and the buffering that we had planned on our common border with her, and she seemed very receptive to it at that time.
Thank you.
Where would her property be in relation to your map?
Right here. It's a gray cape right there on the edge of the field. And there's seven trees proposed here and six along here. She's getting a nice buffer there.
Could I ask a question? What is, as of now, the total number of trees you're going to be adding?
At last count, I believe it is 51.
Wow. Any other questions?
It's on. Is the total number on Mitchell Road any less than it was originally?
No. No. We had at one point asked about taking a few from here and moving them along this border, but I think you expressed concern about that, so we left the original amount and just added from there.
Forgetting about donations of land or whatever some of the other issues were that Mr. Tubbs mentioned, but sticking only with the buffering issue, what have you been asked to do on that side that you haven't done in terms of plantings?
We have not offered to plant as many trees as Mike Drynan asked, or as many as Ed Drynan asked, and Ed also asked for some landscaping on this fill area, which we won't touch until, you know, it's beyond the line where we agreed not to do anything. Michael Drynan, I believe, asked for 13 trees in this short space here, which...
How long is that space?
About 175 feet.
This may be a question for your consultant. Is there, to your knowledge, an accepted buffering standard? If one were to go looking at texts on design and planning, would we find a certain number of trees per certain number of feet?
I think the way to look at that is what are you trying to screen? That is usually the concern, and how much space you have to screen. So there are little things that have to be considered in a question like that. If you're screening an industrial development where you want something instant, the best approach would be to plant trees very close together, say even 5 or 10 feet close together, and then eventually weed them out. I would like to point out, and you can see it on the plan here, that there is a white pine on this border, and right now that white pine is about 30, 40 feet wide. We're planting a total of close to 20 or closer to 20 white pines along here. Eventually, they're going to get quite large and actually dominate, almost overgrow the site. The scale of these trees can get quite large. To keep adding and stuffing, actually, they'll end up crowding each other out, and probably a few will end up dying eventually, because there already is a significant amount of deciduous material along the border, and all these things are going to start competing with each other. And to just keep putting more and more, I don't think it's going to serve a real useful purpose, because eventually some are going to crowd each other out.
What's the total distance that you're being requested to buffer? The 175 feet looked like it was the middle of the lot.
I'd say about, we've been asked to screen about, I'd say more like 700-800 feet. Mr. Drine and Ed Drine, I think, requested at least 220 feet along his property. And then in addition, there are the two properties, the two lots, lot two, and those are about another 300 or 400 feet each. So it's quite a long line of land that is, you know, part of this request. And a line that does have some deciduous material, low-growing and high-growing material on it already.
One thing that's difficult for us to do is to envision what it will be like with houses there. Our goal, or at least my goal, is to comply with the provisions of the subdivision ordinance that allow and seem to point towards adequate buffering. From the standpoint of a planning board doing its job, it seems to me it makes sense that you should require new construction to be a good neighbor, and that doesn't necessarily mean invisible, but it certainly doesn't mean that it should interfere with the use or enjoyment of the next door neighbors any more than is absolutely necessary. And I don't have a feel as to whether 5 more trees at the price that you gave us a month or so ago, which wasn't a lot, or 10 more trees or no more trees, is a big deal or a little deal, or will go a long way towards buffering this site very adequately as opposed to what's there now, or whether what's there now is very adequate. And I have a sense of discomfort because I can't project myself into the future when those houses are built. My sense is that when the houses are built, the neighbors should be looking principally at buffering and not at houses. Is that going to be the case?
Well, of course, the trees start out smaller, so there will be, the houses will be visible if they're built right away, and that's always the case.
You said they're starting out at 6 to 8 feet.
6 to 8 feet. Well, if you're on the second floor, I'm thinking that a house will be taller than that, of course. So you will have, you know, for a few years, some view of houses, and then eventually, again, white pines were chosen because they're very fast growing. So they will fill in probably more quickly than other species. And again, the spacing that we have on a lot of these, plus utilizing what's there, it's going to be pretty much a wall of trees very quickly on the site. And my feeling as a landscape architect is that to keep going on and on is really just throwing in trees that are eventually going to be crowded out and are not going to be useful, and are going to start taking up property on to the homeowners eventually, because they're going to have to deal with these trees that will soon be, you know, could get to 40, 50 feet wide. So we're talking about relatively small lots, and the line and what's, if this was a clean border, I might have other ideas, but it's quite thick right now, if you went out there. It's deciduous, but it's still low-growing and a lot of branching and whatever, so we're not talking about these as being the only thing out there.
A 6 to 8 foot pine tree would have what kind of a breadth, 3 to 4 feet?
I'd say closer to 5, 6 feet. They'll be, you know, start out at least that wide. And pines and white pines tend to grow out horizontally, mm-hmm. so they get very wide.
Question just came to mind when you mentioned the homeowners encroaching on the homeowners. What will be written in the homeowners' documents that will prevent them from cutting these screening trees down? Will there be anything?
In the deed, you have.
Document requires that if the trees die or something happens to them, they have to, I believe the language is, to replace them with the same size trees as originally were approved by the planning board.
Okay, so this is a...
That was in the homeowner's covenants that we have submitted to council, and I believe those have been approved by town council.
Okay, just curious.
Yeah. That provision is also one of the notes on the site, on the subdivision plan itself, so should catch it two ways.
Any other questions on either of these issues?
Mr. Chairman, just a comment, perhaps. We've approved a preliminary plan for the Meadowview subdivision, and now we left open, apparently, the issue of landscaping for final plan review. And it's always been the policy of the town where you have conflicting land uses to provide a buffer screen to ensure that each of the land uses don't intrude on the other, commercial to residential and residential to commercial, farm stand or whatever it might be. And the board has adopted in the past some fairly stringent requirements for buffering and landscaping. This is one of the first times, though, that my being on the board, and that's been several years, where we have attempted to completely buffer residential from residential land uses, from a developed piece of land to a vacant piece of land that is going to be developed. And I guess I'm a little bit surprised at the level of discussion, the type of language that's in some of the letters that are streaming back and forth between the abutters of the property and this subdivision. Given that, I would think that there's been an attempt to provide additional landscaping over what was previously approved by the planning board in its preliminary plan review. And given the fact that we don't typically try to totally buffer residential land uses from residential land uses, that it would appear appropriate, given the level of landscaping that has been proposed for the final plan review. And I would, I'm prepared to make the motions to approve this development on that basis.
Okay, I think before that, though, we do have to find on the completeness of this application, and then I think that motion would be in order. And Mr. Butler has drafted some motions to cover that. If there are no other discussions on the two items that were raised, can we just discuss the issue of completeness? Mr. Butler, are there any items that you see in this application that we should be considering as not complete?
As you may notice in the materials I believe you received this evening, there's a certificate from the town clerk that states what the town council's decision was, and that they, in essence, gave a conditional municipal approval of the public improvements in this development, so that most of the areas at the last meeting, which were left blank, are now put in, filled in with an okay. One area which I raised to the applicant's consultant, and you may want to ask them, just deals with the corner monument markers in terms of whether those are out there. It's my belief, it appears as though that temporary markers have been placed and that final markers will be installed once the construction work's done. But that's something you may want to just get a progress report from the applicant on.
When do you think we could see corner markers, please?
The corner markers were planned to be put in, the permanent ones along the roadway after the construction of the roadway, so they were not damaged during road construction.
So so it would be after construction of the road.
Of the road.
But not the houses.
Right.
Yes, okay.
Okay.
Is that...
Other than that, everything's, yeah, that is, okay. Other than that, everything appears to be in order.
Okay. Then at this point in time, I don't have my motions. We have some motions that have been drafted for us here. Why don't we take a minute to review them, and if somebody would like to so move on one of those, that would be fine. I think the first one that we would like to take a look at is application completeness.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we order that the final plan application of KW Associates for Meadowview, a proposed six-lot subdivision located at 379 Mitchell Road, is deemed to be complete in accordance with Section 16.2.4 and Appendix B of the Subdivision Ordinance and the facts presented.
Is there a second? Any discussion on the issue of completeness? Hearing none, I would call for a vote. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? The motion passes unanimously. The next item, to your point, Mr. Densman, would be the issue of acceptance.
Mr. Chairman, we do have a drafted motion before us, and I had a question regarding the pedestrian bridges that are in conditions C and D of the drafted motion. And just so that everybody understands these two motions, one is that the requirement that two proposed bridges along the town pedestrian easement be constructed and approved prior to issuance of an occupancy permit. And then condition D requires the applicant to ascertain whether or not the Maine Department of Environmental Protection, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, have requirements for permits, and if they do have requirements, that those permits be received prior to certificates of occupancy. I think some of the testimony tonight has indicated that that determination will be made prior to that. I wasn't at the last meeting, and I had understood that the offer for pedestrian bridges had come from the applicant, and not as a requirement of either the Conservation Commission or the town. That made sense from their standpoint for public enjoyment and use of that pedestrian way, which makes a lot of sense. The way the motion is drafted, though, a developer could be under construction with building permits for several of the properties. They could go to the Army Corps of Engineers for a permit, and knowing a little bit about the Army Corps of Engineers, be denied that permit for a pedestrian bridge and have substantial investment in properties being held up from certificates of occupancy because of something the federal government has done, denying a permit for a bridge that they offered in the first place. I just find that rather onerous for us to condition. I've made some changes to the motion that says something like they will build the bridges as they offered because they make sense and a number of other reasons. They will determine whether or not the Army Corps of Engineers and the DEP require permits. They will apply for those permits prior to the occupancy certificates being issued. They will build those bridges if they're permitted by either of those two groups, if they have jurisdiction. But I think that we need to have in our motion a part of that that says if for some reason the Army Corps or the DEP does not permit those bridges for one reason or another, that we've got to be able to deal with the certificates of occupancy in a way that's appropriate. And perhaps we don't require those bridges if the Army Corps of Engineers does not allow the permits for those bridges. So I wanted to raise that for discussion prior to making the motion, because I think it's an onerous one for something that an applicant has offered in the first instance.
So basically you're saying that item C would be constructed by the bridges would be constructed by the applicant.
Period.
Mm-hmm. With no condition on the issuance of occupancy permits.
And then I would have the condition then later in condition D,
mm-hmm.
that I think that it's important, even when an applicant offers to build bridges, to have a time period for those bridges to be constructed. So if they are permittable by the state or federal regulatory agency, then those should be constructed prior to certificates of occupancy being issued by the town. And that'll quick step the process if someone is lagging behind in doing something that they've offered. But I would add a sentence at the end that says, if either agency denies the required permits, then the requirements for said bridges shall be voided.
I'm going to make a suggestion to move this along parliamentary-wise. I'm going to make a suggestion that you make the motion that you just modified, and then we'll open it for discussion.
Okay. Do you want me to read the entire motion?
Would you please?
Thanks. I would move that we order that the Planning Board finds that the final plan application of KW Associates for Meadowview, a proposed six-lot subdivision located at 379 Mitchell Road, meets the standards contained in Section 16.1.1 in Article 3 of the subdivision ordinance. Be it therefore ordered that the request of KW Associates for final plan approval for the Meadowview subdivision be granted according to Section 16.2.4 of the subdivision ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. A, that the irrevocable letter of credit for $107,000 shall be submitted to the town manager and town attorney for their review and approval, and then filed with the town treasurer within 30 days of the date of this approval and prior to the start of any construction on the site. B, that the deed of easement shall be submitted to the town attorney and the town planner for their review and approval prior to the start of any construction on the site. C, that the two proposed bridges located within the town pedestrian easement shall be constructed by the applicant. D, that the applicant shall obtain a determination from the Maine Department of Environmental Protection and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers regarding whether or not a permit or permits are needed for the bridge construction referenced in Condition C above, prior to the issuance of any occupancy permit. If a permit is required by one or both agencies, such permits shall be obtained by the applicant and submitted to the code enforcement officer prior to the bridge construction and the issuance of any occupancy permit. If either agency denies the required permit, then the requirement for said bridges shall be voided.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Discussion.
I'd like to consider amending that to see if we can, or at least I can be more Solomon-like on the buffering thing. If my math is right, we've got 700 feet in dispute, 20 trees on that side. Now, if they do whatever you call a tree doing in terms of buffering, they have 5 or 6 feet. We're talking about something that I don't think is really within the intent of the ordinance, which is, I think I said, wasn't necessary to make houses invisible, but we're talking about 700 feet and maybe 100 feet of it buffered by 6 to 8 foot trees. My math shows me that if they in fact are out to 30 feet when they're fully grown, that may well be a very thorough buffer. I don't know how long that would be, so what I would suggest is that 20 be increased to 30 based upon the prices that you mentioned last time. It shouldn't be an undue economic burden. It comes closer, at least in the initial stages, to buffering about a third, which I think is sort of a minimum that I feel comfortable with. So I would ask if the Planning Board would go along that we amend that motion to require 30 trees on that side.
Okay, I think from my rules, Robert's rules in order are rusty, but I think that the original person who put the motion has to accept that amendment, if I'm not mistaken.
I think otherwise you probably have to vote on it.
Otherwise we have to vote on it, yeah. So, Mr. Tinsman, would you accept that amendment?
I'm not sure I understand, quite frankly. There are 20 trees proposed.
Over what looks like 700 feet, and I'm suggesting 30 of the same size.
Okay. I would amend the motion to add 10 trees to the buffer, presumably along the Drinan property is where you're talking about.
We probably should reference that on, the northern side?
Yeah.
Would that be the northern edge of the property?
I think Steve has it.
Okay. We have an amended motion on E, item E. Any further discussion on this motion?
I think that seems like a reasonable request, because you're not totally blocking out by just adding 10 trees.
Hearing no further discussion, I will call this motion to a vote. All those in favor signify by raising the right hand. Saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? The motion passes unanimously. You have a final plan approval with conditions. Thank you. Do you need that?
Well, I've done it again. I made a terrible mistake. When Ivan asked me about one letter, I took my entire correspondence list, which I should have read, after the minutes, set them aside, and went on with the meeting. So with the planning board's permission, may I read very quickly, out of order, the correspondence, which I neglected to read a few minutes ago. Does anyone? Oh, thank you. From USM, a brochure on course offerings in growth management. I'll read as fast as I can. From COG, a brochure on a meeting concerning pollution of coastal waters. From Vision 2000, a meeting notice. An invitation to the Chamber of Commerce annual dinner on September 21st. From COG, a meeting notice preparing for the 90s on September 20th. From James E. Tierney, Attorney General, a letter concerning the availability of funds from a lawsuit settlement. From the DEP, an issue profile on Great Ponds. From the Maine Department of Economic and Community Development, a harbor and waterfront management for local officials meeting November 20th. Through 21st, from COG, a quarterly planning newsletter. Again from COG, a letter from the new president, Jane Amaro, about the new COG. A letter from Jennifer Logan concerning the Rachel Carson Memorial Conference. A pamphlet from the Cumberland County Affordable Housing Venture. From the State Planning Office, a notice of a seminar on TDRs. A letter from the town manager regarding a change in council rules. A letter from Mr. Walden Randall of 387 Mitchell Road regarding buffering between his home and the proposed Meadowview subdivision. That was dated September 2nd. A letter from Michael Drinan, September 10th, Mitchell Road concerning Meadowview. A letter September 12th from Richard A. Blake representing Constance Reich of Ocean House Road concerning the Thomas Tinsman project. September 7th, a letter from David J. Jones concerning this, the still pending site plan application of Inn by the Sea. From George Marcus, September 18th, regarding the Highlands. From the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, September 15th, regarding the Highlands. From Ed Drinan, September 19th, regarding Meadowview. From the town attorney, September 18th, Meadowview. From Michael Drinan, September 19th, regarding Meadowview. And lastly, from Mr. and Mrs. Schnell and Mr. and Mrs. Green, dated September 19th, concerning the Rummery Public Access Waiver. I thank you. Next on the agenda, oh, and one small announcement, which the wonderful volunteers, our TV crew, has asked me to make. It says, Marion, could you please announce the replay broadcast schedule of the planning board meeting? I mean, it's hard to think that people would be interested in watching us, but September 20th at noon and 4 p.m. we will be on again this meeting. And Again, they will run it on September 21st at noon, 4 p.m. and 7:30 p.m. Okay. Next on the agenda, the Highlands at Broad Cove, which is a 24-lot major subdivision. Is a representative from the Highlands here this evening? Welcome.
Marion, while the representative is proceeding up to the microphone, let me state, I don't think it needs much discussion. I have written a letter to the planning board and indicated that I should abstain from being involved in this application. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the seat that you took.
Okay.
And wish you luck.
Well, thank you very much. I will ask Judith Wyman to please be a voting member in Mr. Boxer's absence.
There'll be other instances tonight for your luck.
Are you ready?
I guess so. My name is Peter Kennedy, and I'm president of the Greater Portland Development Group, the applicant. With me tonight are Paul Frinsko, attorney, Scott Decker, Squaw Bay consultant, engineers, and Bud Brown, eco-analyst. I would presume that you'd like to see an overview of the project as given by Mr. Decker, since he designed it, and if you like, we'll turn it over to him.
Sure.
Take it from there.
Thank you. Yeah. Welcome, Mr. Decker.
Thank you, Peter. As Peter mentioned, I'm Scott Decker from Squaw Bay Corp. We're the consulting engineer that prepared this drawing for the Greater Portland Development Group. What I'll do is give you a brief overview and then open it up and field some technical questions. As you mentioned, the project is a 24-lot subdivision. It's broken down into two phases, a phase one down in this location, which is approximately 28 acres, phase two up in this area, approximately 50 acres. To get you oriented, this is Two Lights Road down here, Pine Ridge, Broad Cove, Hunts Point Road over in this location, and Winding Way down here. The phase one road is a fairly straight shot through the phase one site, beginning at Two Lights Road, coming all the way through the site to Winding Way. I say a straight shot, there are seven small curves along the roadway. What we've tried to do is stay along and out of this brown wetlands area as much as possible. This here, I might add, is a tree line that traverses across the site also. The phase one area is in the residential A zone. As I mentioned, this area down here is a mapped wetland, this brown area, with an inclusion up here in this area. At the entrance to the phase one part of the subdivision, there is an existing structure right down here. The applicant currently plans to remove a portion of that structure and leave the existing building standing. It will require an application to the Zoning Board of Appeals, since the part of the structure planned to be left does extend into the setback. This zone has a 30-foot building setback requirement. It also appears that we'll be disturbing more than 5,000 square feet of wetland area here, with a little bit being disturbed there and a little bit more for a couple of drainage pipes. So there will also be a need for a wetlands alteration permit application, which has not yet been filed, but will soon be filed. A portion of the wetland is currently being planned to be donated to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. That's a 6-acre portion from about midway in the small pond over this area right in here, crosshatched on that plan. Something that we have included or have put on the plan since the submission to the planning board is the building setbacks from the wetland areas. We are currently showing a 25-foot building setback off the wetland. There are no plans at this point in time for public sewer or water. Water for the residences will be by drilled wells, and sewer will be subsurface disposal systems. Storm drainage will be, the road is planned to be a curbed section. There will be four or five locations along the road where drainage pipes will cross the road. And the entire site, except just a small portion of the site right up along the backs of these buildings that front Hunts Point Road, drains across the site to the wetland area. And these drainage pipes will pick up the water and just drop them off in three or four locations across the road. The phase two site up here is a 16-lot subdivision. All of the lots range from 80,000 square feet to about 137,500 square feet. The roadway system extends from Channel View Road through the site in this manner down to Hunts Point Road. There's a small cul-de-sac up here, Heritage Court, approximately 500 feet long, I guess. The storm drainage on the Phase 2 site, again, except for a very small portion of the site up here, which actually drains back towards Hunts Point Road, it drains across the site down to this wetland area. The drainage will be picked up on the road at four or five locations. In a couple of locations, it will be carried right across the road. There are drainage easements that carry the drainage down to ultimately to the wetland. In a couple of locations, the water is picked up, brought along the road longitudinally, and then outletted through those drainage easements. In the phase two area, the total anticipated increase in the rate of runoff is about 3 CFS. Our calculations show that prior to development, we're looking at about 72 CFS in the 25-year frequency storm, and post-development about 75 CFS. We didn't look at, we looked at, but we didn't include any stormwater detention facilities for either phase, the thought being that these wetland areas are quite substantial and will provide a lot of attenuation to that minimal increase in peak rate of runoff. In the phase two area, there is an easement that traverses the site in this manner. It's difficult to see on this plan. It shows up better on the survey plan that's in your packet. What that easement provides is access for, as I understand it, several homeowners up in this area to traverse the site. Our thinking is that the road pretty much follows that alignment through the site. We have provided an easement through here to get pedestrians over to Two Lights Road. I think basically that's a brief overview, and if you'd like, I'd open it up to questions.
Is anyone else speaking from the group that has appeared here tonight? Is anyone else presenting any
questions?
Okay. All right. Well, I'd like to ask a question.
Sure.
I guess the first one is a very simple one. When the group came before us a few months ago, you did not have really a complete formalized plan, but you had proposed 11 lots at that time. Now we've really more than doubled the number of lots. Is there a reason for that change?
Yes, I would turn that over to
which
the
seems it's a very
the,
big
the intent
change.
Of the 11 lot subdivision was to minimize roads, the building of roads, the construction of roads, create a through road from Hunts Point Road to Two Lights Road, but have it be a private way. In my discussions with Steve Butler, Mike McGovern, and others, the private road idea, and I guess our reaction from the planning board at the pre-application conference, was that that was not going to fly.
I don't remember the planning board committing to any ideas concerning roads.
No, there was no commitment.
Whether public, private, or otherwise.
There was no commitment.
Hmm.
It was, that's the reaction we were looking for. We didn't get a reaction, and the people I spoke to, particularly at the staff level, indicated that we were really crazy to think that we were going to get really no roads and all private roads. So we went back to the drawing board and designed a subdivision that we felt met the ordinance. Believe me, I don't want to build long town roads, but we felt to meet the ordinance and to come up with a design that was economically practical, we had to create 5,000 plus feet of town road, because the private road didn't seem to be able to work.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions on that?
Just to pick up on that point, I certainly, for one, would like to perhaps correct a conception that you might have gained from this member of the planning board. I thought 11 lots was a far superior plan to what you had offered even previously, and I thought it was well put together as far as lot size. I think there probably is a way to get around the road construction so that we can both have a second access to this area and also create the kind of land use for buildings that would be desirable for the town of Cape Elizabeth. I just want to register that impression.
Good. Thank you. Any other comments?
Madam Chairman, I have a number of questions after reviewing the application. And you all have touched on the road issue, which I think will remain an issue throughout the technical review of the subdivision, the proposed subdivision. My understanding, though, at this first meeting is that this is the initial presentation of a plan that is desired and proposed by the owner, developer, applicant. That we have to issue a dated receipt this evening, which presumably we'll do. We have 30 days to determine application completeness, which I presume we would take. And go through the issues as required by our ordinance. In addition to those steps, though, there may be some technical issues that we may want to talk about this evening before we talk about whether the application is complete or incomplete. Because there has been a long history, as alluded to, with this piece of land, with three different developers now, and several years of people coming before the board and proposing different scenarios for roads, different scenarios for numbers of lots, and even different scenarios for what constitutes a wetland.
Right.
So I think that, if I might, Madam Chairman, I'd like to ask a couple of the issues that, having served on the board, have been asked before, not necessarily of this applicant, but of previous applicants as well, and maybe we can get some answers and keep the process going in a timely fashion and yet deal with some of the substantive issues that the board feels. So
please
if I
do.
Might. The first issue relates to a discussion that we had several years ago when the proposal first came to us by another developer, and it related to the re-subdivision of an existing residential subdivision that was previously approved by the planning board. At that time, members of the planning board indicated that in order for roads to be put in where house lots were once shown and approved, that that would require a re-subdivision of the property and consideration as a re-subdivision of a previously plotted plan. I don't see anything in this application that indicates that there's a request for a re-subdivision approval of a previously approved plat in the town. I raise the issue to give a hint to the applicant that that is an issue that should be looked at legally, and that we would expect their response to that question. If I might continue, I'm sure they'll write down some of these issues. In going through the application, the eco-analyst report cites maps. Those maps are not included in their reports, but then transferred to maps that are proposed by the applicant. I would presume that if a report is reproduced in whole in an application, that those maps would serve as a part of that report, not be taken out of that report and then put on the applicant's own maps. There are sites in that report for numbers of the wetlands and designations that don't appear on the applicant's maps, and I, for one, would like to see those maps by eco-analysts as a report. Because of the history of this project, too, with the number of applicants, we've received a few indications of what are wetlands in this land area. This last one constrains or brings back, at least in one location, or shrinks the amount of wetland. That's of concern. There's now inconsistent data or contradictory data that has been proposed by the applicant. This is the first formal application, but there has been other data submitted. I don't know what we do with contradictory data other than perhaps review, and we may have to ascertain on our own the extent of wetlands. Knowing a little bit about the core process and having had the privilege and pleasure of working with the core on occasion, I smile at that. I know that often they walk the sites to approve the designation of what is a wetland, so that may be a possibility. I had some questions on the test pits. Our own ordinance and their application show the requirement for one test pit at each corner of a proposed wastewater disposal site. There is only one. Our town engineers indicated that there is some inconsistency between what is shown on the plan and what is shown in the report. I would think that that would want to be resolved early. Have a question about the site distances at Winding Way and whether they are appropriate. I didn't, and I may have missed it, I didn't see anything in the report that indicated what our site distances are as a new road enters that. There will always be the question, I presume, about an imaginative road layout for the subdivision. I would hope that the applicant is interested in working with the town to refine and perhaps even further define what is an imaginative road layout for a very constrained site and with some town requirements that are imposed on them as an applicant. Understanding those town requirements, there may be other things that could be done. So we'll be having some technical discussion about that as we get into the technical review and process. Had a question about rare endangered species. I know an evaluation was done a year ago by the Maine Critical Areas Program. I have not seen anything in their application that reflects that. My understanding is that there are endangered or threatened species, plant species on the site. I would think that we would certainly want to have a full briefing on that and a full evaluation and to ensure that threatened species are not in any way intruded on and are preserved. I presume that the applicant has already done that, given the level of detail that has already been done and studies that have been that have occurred on the site. We don't see any of that data in our applications. I'm just blowing through this thing with just thoughts. Is that what you want?
Please continue. Okay. Sure.
I'm concerned about public water not being supplied and wastewater disposal sites on the same sites, particularly where 15 lots out of the 24 that are proposed indicate marginal soils for wastewater disposal. That is a bit incredible to me that an applicant would propose both wastewater, on-site wastewater and on-site wells, given the nature of the soils in this area. I think that we're going to need a very technically detailed report to show that those two can coexist, either that or the provision of public water, which I would think would be far more important for the town to ensure is placed on the site. And then perhaps one of the last issues that I see in just in a quick reading of having this only a couple of days as an application, I'm concerned that we have a long road that extends along a wetland boundary on the southern side of the site, fairly close to the wetland boundary. That boundary will be further refined and determined, I would imagine, through our own studies of those of the applicants. But I also noticed that in the road fill, there are places where the road is filled up to 4 feet, and it may be more. I didn't do a complete evaluation of that myself. If that's the case, and we do have a 4-foot road fill, then the side slopes from that could extend out a considerable distance, potentially into the wetland area as well. We don't see that on any of our plans. I would think that we would want to see that as well. Maybe the last issue that was quickly that I quickly noticed that we had requested once before still does not show on the plans, but this applicant wasn't requested this data, I don't believe. And that was all of the property owners that are abutter shown as property owners with buildings on them. There are a number of houses that have been built along Hunts Club Wood, Hunts Point Road. Over the years, and this appears to be an old map that Alan Balfour used, and we asked the same question then that had new houses on it. Now we're a couple years later and we still don't have those houses. So this is the first time Mr. Kennedy has heard that as a request, perhaps, but that's something that should be done and is a requirement of our ordinance.
Well, thank you. That was an excellent almost.
That's a two-day review, so I'm not sure that that's an excellent, but there are a whole bunch of issues.
There are indeed, and you alluded to one that is of concern to me, the wells and the lack of fire hydrants, I think, the lack of the water supply. And you have alluded, Mr. Tinsman, several times to a study that we might do. Could you say any more about that? Do you think because this land is so fragile that the planning board should initiate some sort of a wetlands study?
Well, many times in the past, the planning board has conducted its own wetland evaluation with consultants from Normando Associates to evaluate the extent of wetlands and to double check the applicant's provisions and to ensure that the federal standards for through the Corps of Engineers, through the Federal Register are being met, which our ordinance alludes to and incorporates, I believe, by reference. I think that has proven to be a valuable exercise not only for the town but for the applicant. To ensure that they don't get later hung up in the federal requirements or guidelines that have been developed. Now, the applicant has submitted a somewhat detailed report on wetland determination. I guess my concern is that it's contradictory to a previous one. It's either a refinement or a contradiction. I'm not sure which, but it may be appropriate for us to do our own.
Right.
There are also provisions within our ordinance for assessment of fees that presumably have been accomplished, and there are money set aside. Our ordinance recognizes the fact that the planning board may need technical assistance,
right,
and I think we should avail ourselves of that, as we have in the past.
One caution on that point, and I think your review is excellent, Stinsman. Based on our last workshop meeting with Mike McGovern, this request for additional services would have to be directed through his office. I mean, you should be cautious that we do that.
Mm-hmm. Mrs. Rand, do you?
Oh, well, I concur that that's the route we should go.
Right.
I also agree that this is a rather sizable area of wetlands, and I think that it behooves us to pay attention both to the state's Natural Resources Protection Act and the clarification that has been recently made in the concerning the public laws that were adopted in the state legislature in 1989. We are really, in effect, told that we have authority to review and impose a very intricate review of significant wildlife habitats. So I think it's important to make sure that the work is carefully and meticulously done. In this area.
Exactly. Thank you. And I think your opinion is reinforced, and yours too, by the letter that we have from our town engineer dated September 11th. Are you in possession of this?
I personally haven't seen it, but I've talked with
it's an excellent letter. It was the town engineer's preliminary review, and it's 3 pages in length. And it mentions much of the soils on the site are shallow to bedrock and are marginal for subsurface wastewater disposal. That's just one of the statements. If the wells are utilized, there is a possibility that the residents will petition the town at a later time to have water. And on it goes for 3 pages. It alludes to easements, drainage problems, the need for an expanded stormwater study. I could just go on and on. It was an excellent job by Mr. Hunter. So I hope that you will read this before the next time.
We wanted to meet with Mr. Hunter prior to the meeting. Weren't able to.
Mm-hmm.
In listening to most of those comments, I think they're easily resolvable once we have a chance to meet with him and discuss the project with him.
Mm-hmm.
Madam Chair,
yes.
Is it appropriate at all to discuss perhaps some possible other configurations of road design so that we could try to find a better way of meeting the town's desire to have a second access, yet perhaps reduce the number of houses that are proposed. I just wonder, there is a paper street which comes right above lot 4. And I wonder if there were a way of running Farm Pond Road in, avoiding crossing the wetlands and going up that paper street, and then perhaps being able to develop lots on the other side of Farm Pond Road without interfering with the wetlands by running in with a cul-de-sac, if that were something to think about in design.
Well, actually, we had considered that earlier. In fact, we came to the town with a proposal and showed this road looping up to Hunts Point Road. This road coming in just a short distance and with a cul-de-sac that fed a couple of lots over here. And we're advised that there were benefits to be derived from a straight through road here that might not be derived from this arrangement, so we regrouped and came back with this.
Could someone ask what benefits to be derived and where that came from?
Who said, did somebody enumerate those benefits?
Well, the road, there was a filed map indicating that road going from Winding Way to Lutz, way back when. It's a paper street. The fire chief, my discussions with him up until a few years ago, he used to use it. He endorsed the idea of going from Two Lights to Winding Way for fire access. And once again, he did use the old road. The old road was there. In our discussions with other people in the town, they indicated that they felt personally that that was their best alignment. For my purposes, I recognize the board has always said they want another access to Two Lights. And it has to go, I believe, on the south side. That's the only place we have a consistent 50 feet in width, whereas the north side, there's a 45-foot right-of-way and not a 50-foot right-of-way. But if the road were here and out, or all the way through, with a here and out with a cul-de-sac here or all the way through, it doesn't make too much difference to me.
Well, that's nice to hear, because I think at least many people on the planning board are averse to filling wetlands to putting a road through, and I just think that ought to be reconsidered, that kind of scheme, or one that avoids having to go through a large wetland area.
The previous submission that we did on the pre-application basis engineered a road all the way through. It did require, however, that there be a request for public access waivers on frontage on the cul-de-sac, on cul-de-sacs, to shrink the road on the cul-de-sac and on the Winding Way end. And I was informed that there's no guarantee of public access waivers, therefore show the 200 feet per lot and don't rock the boat. So that's what we did.
Did that advice come from the planning board?
From a planning board member and Steve Butler, and I'm trying to think who else.
I've never known Steve not to suggest that you not rock the boat. He likes to rock the boat.
He rocks it.
I don't know why.
As a matter of fact.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
But there's no guarantee that you get the public access waiver for diminishing street frontage. And if you can't show the street frontage, why do you need a waiver? Just trying to take the path of least resistance.
The plot thickens.
Madam Chairman, further to that question that Alice is raising, and another question from a design standpoint that I had that's different from what we had before. The road that comes in on the northern part of the subdivision, which is an extension of one of the existing roads in Broad Cove,
Channel View,
originally showed as a cul-de-sac off Channel View and as a cul-de-sac off from Hunts Point Road. Now we have a through road, and I guess I'd be interested in why the applicant is proposing that rather than two cul-de-sac roads. One of our ordinance provisions is to discourage through traffic, of course understanding the peculiarities of this site and the requirement for a second public access to Broad Cove, which we all understand. Why did you put that road through, if I might?
Provision in the ordinance on length of cul-de-sac.
Maybe you could come to the microphone too. They will have
the
hard time.
Provision in the ordinance for the maximum length of cul-de-sac. We would have to count Channel View as well. So, is it 600 feet?
500.
500 feet. That would be the cul-de-sac would end here. That would mean this cul-de-sac would end here. I have no way of getting into here without a through road.
or without a waiver to that requirement. Does the end
That's
of
correct.
Channel View Road, is that 500 feet as a cul-de-sac right at the end of the road right now?
I don't know that.
Okay. You had just indicated 500 feet puts a cul-de-sac right well, at the end.
I would guess it would. I mean, just from visual, I haven't taken a tape measure. But, well, this is a scale of 1 to 100. And Channel View Road ends here. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, maybe 6 inches. Mm-hmm. So I think we're at its maximum. It's at its maximum, according to the ordinance, right as it is.
Well, did you ever get any feedback from the board that they would not approve a longer cul-de-sac than 600, 500 feet?
No. Okay. We tried to stay by the ordinance. The ordinance may want to create an imaginative subdivision, but when you read the ordinance letter by letter, it discourages cul-de-sacs because of the frontage requirement and the length. So it's somewhat contradictory.
Madam Chairman, if
yeah,
I may, just to clarify, the standard is 500 feet with an allowance up to 1,000 feet if it serves imaginative development or some other purpose.
And we do have other provisions that discourage through traffic, which will be an issue, I presume, in this application as well.
Any other comments from members? Ivan?
Yeah, just a question. On the Heritage Court Channel View Road intersection, is the application, does the application show site distance calculations there?
For this intersection?
Yeah. For
no,
that
we haven't.
That will be something we'll want to look at, especially with that sure. curve you show there. Just scaling it off of my pen, it looks like you've got 200 feet. It looks like you may need more than that.
Good point, Ivan. Any other questions?
Just maybe a question to Mr. Hunter's comment about not using public water and public sewers. I think particularly where we're in a sensitive area where there are wetlands, there are a lot of problems when you juxtapose wells with
believe me, if we could put in water and sewer, I'd love to do it. The site is a lot of ledge. If you're putting in a water line, you might as well be putting in a sewer line. It's my understanding that we cannot put in a sewer line.
Does not qualify for sewer, I don't think.
Mm-mm. Therefore, we must have septics and a very long road through ledge, which makes the water line extremely costly. There are fire hydrants sprinkled all around the site. I think, with my discussions with John Libby of Portland Water District, that we can engineer hydrants to within 1,000 feet of each house with no problem.
With wells?
With wells. And some would be on, some of the homes would be on town water, some would be on wells.
How many homes would be of this 24 lot subdivision?
Guessing about half.
We've got to, we can't guess. We've
no,
got
well,
to know.
I understand that. But the, I've spoken to the fire chief and I recognize his concerns. We even had a discussion on putting sprinkler systems in the houses, which we've done in other dead ends that are 4 miles long with no water, no public water, which is, I think, a far better safety measure. Mm-hmm. However, he's not convinced. He says, I really want public water. Well, there are hydrants. I mean, there's a hydrant down here. We can put one here. There's a hydrant here. We can put one here. There's a hydrant here. We can put one here. There is a hydrant here. We can even move it into here. And we're easily within 1,000 feet of every house.
Mm-hmm.
The Portland Water District is looking at this now for a system for hydrants, and we'll call it quasi public water.
Quasi? What
meaning
is quasi?
Meaning not be servicing the whole site.
But you have just heard the letter from our town engineer that mixing the wells and the septic systems just might not work.
Well, that's an issue that we really want to talk to Mr. Hunter about, obviously.
And I think that you should look at supplying water to all of the houses, not half. I mean, I really get concerned about wells. We have a history here of, I think it was 2 years ago, an entire road was ripped up at town expense, and water pipes, I'm sure it was at town expense, had to be put under that road because of wells that were malfunctioning or drying up. You know, these things happen, and I certainly, sitting here right now, from the ordinances that we need to approve this project, I couldn't vote yes with the engineering report that we have, because I would be very afraid that with these fragile soils, that 5 years down the road, the town would have to rip up that straight shot of a road and any other roads where those wells and septic systems were mixed in. And there might be contamination, or wells can dry out. So, you know, an adequate water supply is a very fundamental thing that the planning board looks at.
So adequate as far as potability or fire?
I think in every way.
I agree, and I also agree or am concerned with septics when the sewer surrounds the site. It's not available to us.
There's also a history, we can talk about wells, there's a history of septic systems failing in that entire area. You know that.
Mm-hmm.
Madam Chairman.
Yes.
that raises a question, a technical question that I wanted to ask the applicant. What is the minimum amount of cover given our winter conditions over a water line that may be insulated? How close to the surface can you put a water line of the size that would have to service this for public and potable water, public fire protection and potable water?
Do you know the answer?
Rule of thumb would be 5 feet.
With insulation above it?
Oh, with insulation. No, you could 2 inches of insulation, 3 feet.
How deep will you be burying the conduit for cable TV and electrical service in the site?
You can bury it a minimum of 18 inches.
Okay, so you're talking about another foot and a half of trenching.
As a practical matter, if you're going to bury a water line 3 feet in ledge, you might as well go and bury it 5 feet. Because the cost of the insulation will just about amount to the extra 2 feet of blasting, since you have to go under the water pipe anyway. So you overblast and be done with it. But it's not an inexpensive process.
But the issue that I question, the minimum amount of cover over line given insulation, a couple inches of insulation would be 3 feet. And yes, you would have to be below it to bed the pipe down.
And that's underneath. Within the roadway, the cable TV and electrical services are usually on the side of the road for maintenance.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't want to blast out a 30-foot section of roadway just for a water line.
Well, again, it's a technical issue that I raised that mm-hmm. should be looked at before it's discarded solely. And we may need ledge profiles to see if that's the case and at what point this applicant is affected by a high ledge profile, so that water cannot be serviced, if that's the testimony of the applicant.
Right. The soils map, it would have been so helpful to have a key. I haven't memorized all of the soils yet. Alice Rand knows them all. But I haven't memorized them. You know, like if you could provide us with a key on that soils map, like S-O.
I thought there was a key. There was a missing item on the key. Yes.
Right.
The Scarborough soils were not included in the key.
S-O.
Yeah. Yes. Scarborough.
Oh, Scarborough. I thought it stood for soil.
That's a little wet. That's Scarborough, so.
Could there be some legal issues on rights of way, too? within the land?
Councilor Prinsco.
Madam Chairman, I know you've been lobbied by communications. Let me just say this.
We're always lobbied by communications.
Well, you won't get any from me if I can help it. The simplest way to answer this without being, I don't mean to be fresh, but in all fairness, the issue of whether or not a private right-of-way exists is not an issue for the Cablesworth Planning Board to determine. The Maine Supreme Court has made that absolutely clear. I think you folks are aware of it. Having said that, that's my fallback position. Having said that, let me just explain to you. The issue was addressed to the owner that there may be a right-of-way that was to serve a parcel down here out to Two Lights, going across Mr. Kennedy's property. A very reputable surveying firm, E.C. Jordan, who I think you're quite familiar with, produced a survey after going through and using all of the techniques and indicia of ownership and use and location and history and historical research and registry research, and concluded on their expert opinion that the right-of-way does not go as Mr. Marcus would like it to go. What we did was to invite Mr. Marcus to produce any evidence he can and any surveying information he'd like to produce for our review. To date, we've received nothing. Our engineers, our surveyors conclude, and our title research people conclude, that simply the right-of-way is as shown on the survey submitted in this application.
Well, we're not a court of law.
And
we certainly
it's none of your business to be nice
that.
About it. It's not your role to decide
no,
that private dispute.
We are aware.
So it's not a legal issue before the planning board.
No, it isn't. I didn't say it was before the planning board.
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
If I might, I missed something.
Well, you don't miss much, Richard. I'm sure of that. what
thank
did you
sir.
Miss?
Who is Mr. Marcus, and
this
where
is
the issue?
We have
received... Oh, I have a communication addressed to the planning board.
We
assume you all got it.
We have received several letters from Mr. Marcus concerning a right-of-way.
Is that in this package?
Is that in our package?
No, no, not currently. It just came in late.
Yeah, it's not in our package.
It came in.
I looked for it.
Allegedly, it was sent to you several times.
This is dated September 18th. There was another one which I had turned over to you and acknowledged several months ago on the Highlands. But since this letter from Mr. Marcus is dated September 18th, it has not been duplicated as yet for our
Madam
package.
Chairman, could I ask, because it seems to have produced some heated discussion here tonight, I hate to be left out of heated discussions when I'm supposed to make a decision at some point. Could you just, as the chairman of the planning board, tell us what the issue is?
Well, it has to do
and
with
where it is on the
with
site.
A right-of-way. Could you explain it, Steve?
Well, the correspondence doesn't lend much guidance to some of the questions that you have. It appears as though Mr. Marcus, though, owns a parcel piece of property. Paul, if you could indicate where it is on the northerly parcel.
Right. This one?
Right.
I'm sorry. I went the wrong
right there.
Side.
And that he appears to, as far as you can put together, because he doesn't include any maps with his materials, that he feels that the right-of-way that's shown on the plans actually kind of veers and somehow connects up with his parcel. The applicant is stating that they feel that the right-of-way is as it appears on their plans that they've submitted to you. So that's the issue. One. And it appears that perhaps a number of people have rights to the right-of-way, regardless of where it lies on the land, which is something we have to look at in terms of what those rights are. Secondly, it appears as though Mr. Marcus's concern may be regarding the actual location of the right-of-way, in addition to what those basic rights would be, wherever it is located on the face of the earth.
Does this relate to Channel View Road?
Yes, it does.
And this is a... the abutters indicating that he feels he has an interest in land that's proposed to be used for the road extension.
Yes. And we cannot make any legal judgments, but we do read our correspondence.
Some of us do.
Some of us haven't gotten it.
Well, I have read that letter.
Madam Chairman, I don't like to see exchanges between attorneys and our planning board not understanding
right.
at least some of the background to it.
It should have been in your packet the last time. Tonight, since we just received it, I'm sure Steve will be running it off to place in the packets the next
time.
Madam Chairman, the letter refers to what I believe were prior communications to the planning board, and I apologize. I thought you all had it because the letter refers to dates of earlier submissions to you.
It has been in my packet.
It also includes...
No, much earlier.
Right. So at some point, I think you've received one, if not more. We'll make sure that before the next meeting, you receive all of them. Mr. Marks's letter, the most recent letter, dated September 18th, in fact, conveniently has copies of his previous letters with it, so that'll make it nice and easy. I'll copy all three of the
great
items. You'll get it. Then you'll have about the same questions that you have now, but at least you'll have.
Well, I can help Dick just a second by using this plan and make it very, very simple. Mr. Marcus says his right of way goes this way. E.C. Jordan says it goes this way. Very simple.
Okay, and always one to want the most complete data. If there is a dispute involved, we might at least want to serve the public interest by having correspondence before us, have our own attorneys review and comment
Absolutely.
To the board, its powers and duties and responsibilities. I'm sure that they'll be the same as Mr. Frinsco's, and that would make us feel all that much more comfortable.
Of course it would. Thank you.
When you get to that portion of the program that talks about reviewing the application for completeness, I'll come back.
Okay. You might as well stay. I'm sure we're going to get to that immediately, Mr. Frinsco. Any other comments or input from the planning board to these applicants?
Madam Chairman,
yes.
I would hope that we've taken some time to talk about some of the technical issues. And I hope that those comments are perceived as being important comments for the applicant to hear, even before the completion, application completeness review, because they're the things that surface to our minds as we at first look at the application. So I hope they're helpful. I hope that they're issues that can be addressed.
Madam Chairman,
sure.
Just to sound an old refrain, I would like to encourage the developers to be in touch with the Conservation Commission early in the game, so that because they are advisory to us and will help us in understanding these vast wetlands.
Yeah, in one
good point.
While I issued a caution about bringing professionals on without talking to Mike, I strongly support in the case of this application assistance to our planning board in the area, especially of wetlands determination, and hopefully we'll have that assistance when we make a site walk. I know I've gone through a number of these site walks where wetlands were an issue, and I was befuddled by what was and was not a boundary. And it would be very helpful here on this one to have the assistance of some professionals that answer to the town so that we can be a little bit more cautious about this issue, because there is a lot of wetlands and it's going to be difficult to determine where they are, I think.
Good point. Steve, perhaps we could discuss the process in approaching the town manager about this situation. Okay.
I don't have any problem doing that. I think what he's going to say, and I think what the town planning board's basic approach has been is to ask the applicant for about as much information, as much clarification
right.
as possible. And if the board still feels uncomfortable and feels like it needs a second opinion at that point, then going out. So the board
right.
may want to discuss at what point it's reached or will reach before it goes to the town manager. But when that decision's made, more than happy to talk to Mike McGovern.
Very good. Thank you. Any other comments or questions before we get to the issue of the completeness of this application. Could you fill us in if no one has any more questions or comments, Steve, on the completeness of this application?
Sure. Just going down the checklist, this was submitted to you, and the applicant, I know, has at least one copy. Everything appears to be okay down to 4D, which talks about existing buildings, and that deals with the issue partially that Dick raised in terms of where the building locations are in terms of existing structures.
Madam Chairman, before we start this process, and Steve is starting through it and indicating that everything is okay to a certain point, in terms of the checklist, that is what Steve is doing, whether information is supplied or not.
Right.
This board has 30 days to determine whether it is a complete or an incomplete application. I would suggest that the board do that with a provision that our engineer has still only issued a preliminary report, that there may be other technical data that he sees that would be required, such as the extent of road filling into that wetland, given the amount of fill on the road. So, as Steve is saying, everything is okay down to item number four. Mm-hmm. I think that that's a checklist review and maybe not a complete technical review of completeness and incompleteness of technical data.
I think that's a very good point. It's something that the planning board's discussed in workshop session several times, and we're just dealing with has it been submitted, not whether or not not whether it's adequate in terms of being
or complete
or truly complete. Okay. So existing buildings, not all the structures adjacent to the site are shown on the application plans at this point in time. Going down to water supply, the...
Madam Chairman, number
yes.
Six, names of adjoining property owners, that's an issue that I raised earlier. The names of the adjoining property owners are not consistently shown on the plans. Or maybe it wasn't on the ones that I looked at, but I may not have looked at the survey plan.
I believe the applicant made an attempt to try and update some of them in terms of the property owners, but we'll look at that again. So.
Okay. When we talk about site plans and look at the site plans and the detailed drawings, you're probably right. I did not look at the survey. It's probably on there. It's not on the other drawings, and I should look at that survey.
That's one. There are quite a few drawings, and it takes a fair amount of time just to get through them once just to know what's there.
Yes. Only having had 3 days, I didn't look at the survey.
Okay. Going down, and feel free to raise any issue. This is just my analysis, and it's the planning board that actually makes the determination. In terms of water supply, they pretty much what I could see were just some written information alluding to the fact that they were going to be using private wells, and a letter from the Brunswick Well Company. Didn't talk anything more than that, didn't show any locations in terms of where the potential wells would be. 8D deals with hydrant locations. There weren't any shown on the plan submitted. Subsurface sewage disposal system data, again, partial. They have one test pit, sometimes more on the sites, but they don't have five corners shown. And the town engineer also referred to some inconsistencies. If you hold on a second, I want to change the tape just a minute.
He's changing a tape. We record this on tape, so bear with us.
Madam Chairman, while we're changing tapes, could I ask the developer where the squash houses are? I think that's wonderful, you're saving them.
Oh, okay.
Just for curiosity.
So one photograph again.
Oh.
He's just showing her where. Thank you. Okay, you can resume.
Okay.
Steve will go on with his checklist now, and thank you for the pretty pictures.
That is the squash house.
Okay. This is the squash house. That. Isn't that nice?
We don't have the same picture.
Wheeler's General Store in Dansville.
I don't know if the public can see it. It's far away. Pass it on. Okay, we'll go on with our checklist, please.
In terms of going through onto the second page of the checklist on 10D, in terms of building, building location data, the building lines and building envelope, so to speak, isn't on it. It's a relatively minor point. But they show the lot lines, and it, they've indicated that they will be putting the building envelope lines right on the plans themselves. In terms of the soils report and the high-intensity soil survey, 12B dealt with a very minor point, and not all the soils were indicated. Appears as though that's minor and will be corrected if it hasn't already. In terms of the soils report, one thing I was looking for, there are several things that are perhaps out there and we would like to have the town engineer review it in more detail. One thing I was looking for was a description of what actually constituted the high intensity soils aspect of it. I stated that it was, but didn't give any map unit description. I think that's important in this case, since soils as well as wetlands vegetation are going to be very important. 12C, the lot-by-lot soil suitability analysis, is something that the board's going to want to look at soon, I think, after a discussion with the town engineer, to see if that's something that may be required for this project. The track boundary line survey, pretty much all that was found there dealt with the deed restrictions that deal with the survey, with the overall site. Temporary markers. Again, that's something that you don't expect to see at the first meeting, but will expect to see at the site walk. The public use land item number 17, they show the area to be donated to the land trust. Discussions with the applicant have stated that there will be other pedestrian easements located on the site, but those aren't indicated, so those would need to be added. And needs to be clarified exactly what could be used in the wetland areas and the boundaries of those. Natural features, again, there's a perhaps a question about wetland boundaries, but the major issue there is the fact that there's no discussion about wildlife habitat. So that was the major issue under 18, and the reason why it's partial. Under 22, grading and landscaping plan, they really didn't discuss landscaping at all, didn't identify existing strands of trees or trees of major of significance that perhaps will be retained throughout the development. And last item in terms of my comments on completeness dealt with the community impact statement. And it's felt that the it was perhaps shorter rather than longer, but two areas which were lacking in terms of breadth of analysis dealt with the recreational needs of the area and also the wildlife habitat analysis portions of the of that analysis document. And that's it.
There are no questions remaining on right title and interest. Just asking a question.
There very well may be. They did submit material that, you know, at least that to a point indicated that they were indeed the owners of the property in question. It's not to state that other sorts of research may be needed.
Steve, on the process, have you gentlemen been to the zoning board yet? Usually, after the zoning board, applicants come to us. When do you plan on going to the zoning board? have you been?
We have not been. Upon your direction, we can go now or later.
Well, what does the rest of the planning board think about it? What do you think, Dick?
The question is, do you want to preserve that barn, or do you want me to tear it down? I want to keep it up.
Madam Chairman, the planning board, when Mr. Kennedy first came in several years ago, or a couple of years ago, requested consideration for saving that structure. And it's good to see the real desire on the part of the applicant to save that. And whatever can and should be done to preserve that building, I think, would be in the town's best interest.
Right.
And I would think that that's an important consideration for the planning board as it considers the application. Originally, after the applicant had decided to attempt to save it,
yeah,
who's going to move it, I guess the determination is that there would be more damage done to the structure if it was attempted to be moved than it would be then preserved. So it's important to us to know that that's going to be tracking, and I would think mm-hmm. that the sooner that the applicant could get before the zoning board, regardless of whether this is a public street or a private street going in or whatever
right.
the form and course that it might take, there'll still be the requirement for a setback.
Right.
And to the extent that we even support that application before the Board of Appeals, I would like to see us do that.
Good. So I guess the advice from most of the planning board is that you should go soon. Okay. When, if this applicant wanted to appear next month, Steve, what is his deadline for submittals?
The quick answer is 18 days before the planning board meeting, but I think it's right around the end of
18 days before the 18 days, I'll try to figure
the next
out.
Planning board meeting is on October 18th.
So, September.
The September the 29th.
September the 29th. Thank you. So, if you could get your information to Steve at that time. Did you have something to say?
Well, yes, Madam Chairman. I told you I'd come back when you started reviewing
mm-hmm.
Completeness.
Right.
I also, since the planning board appears to be headed towards selecting some additional assistance, before you do that, I'd like you to take a moment to hear from Mr. Brown from Echo and Allen so he can tell you how he mapped the site and describe to you any, or perhaps even alleviate any confusion you might have about prior submissions. But first of all, there's a couple of issues that we should resolve. The legislature has now given you folks three bites at the apple instead of one. We go to your regulations and you say to us, submit what's required in Appendix B. I understand that planning board may want to augment that. And in a couple of occasions, you have the authority to augment the submissions. It would be inappropriate, I think, to wait 30 days, and I hear a suggestion being made that we've got 30 days, let's take it. It would be inappropriate to wait 30 days to exercise your discretionary authority to request additional information of the applicant. I think it's only fair that if you know you want more, you have the authority to request it. Please request it now, so we won't put this thing on the burner again for the delay. And those two areas are in a soils analysis and in a community
impact
analysis. They were volunteered to you, at least what the applicant thought was adequate to meet that requirement, was volunteered to you before you requested. If there are specifics in there that you would like to augment, please as a board tell us now, so we won't come back 30 days from tonight and find out there's something else you want.
Dick.
Madam Chairman, I've heard the applicant say a couple of times tonight that in order to meet the letter of our ordinances, this is being proposed as suggested. I understand that, and that's an appropriate comment for an applicant to suggest. But now, the applicant's attorney is saying the town has 30 days, but it would be inappropriate to make the applicant wait that long.
No. I'm saying where you have discretion to request additional information, and you know you're going to request it, and there's two areas where you can do it, it would be helpful to have you do it now and not wait 30 days and then ask it, wait another 30 days to submit it. That's all I'm asking.
Madam Chairman, let me to continue.
Go ahead, please.
The issue of application completeness is different from information being appropriate for decisions. We've talked about that as a board many times. And I know that Mr. Frinsco is aware of not only our regulations, but a lot of other communities' regulations. We've had this application for 3 days as a planning board. It's a lengthy application. It is professionally done. It's a good application. And we know that there are some things missing from the application. Those have been cited in Mr. Butler's review of the checklist, where indications are that it's either partial, that it's okay for application completeness or not. In addition to that, we've had at least one report from the town engineer that indicates from a technical review that there are areas that he questions. Those are technical reviews. He also has not done any evaluation of whether the data is complete as an application submission. What I'm suggesting to the board is that it take the time. We're allowed one shot to give an applicant a decision in writing whether or not it's a complete application for preliminary review, not a verbal indication at the board, but a written determination of whether it's a complete application. That's a one-shot issue that this board has. In order to meet the letter of our own ordinances, we should make sure that that is the most complete determination for written evaluation to the applicant that the application is complete or not complete. What I'm suggesting to the board is that we take that time, we make sure that that is a complete written description of whether the application is complete or incomplete. And I say that not to slow the process, but to say that this board and other boards across the state have continuously requested data from applicants in the past, almost building on the last meeting, so that the data is never really complete. I think our ordinance is written in a way that smooths the process by requiring this board to give that written determination, and I would suggest the board take that and do it.
Any comments on what Mr. Tinsman has just said?
I want to make certain you understand that I agree with Mr. Tinsman. He thinks I'm quarreling with him. There are two areas, however, where the planning board has the discretion to ask for information. It's not required for the submission. You've been discussing it this evening. If you know you're going to ask it, and it's discretionary whether you ask it, all we're saying is, why don't you ask it tonight? Don't put it in writing. Just ask it, so that we'll have it in to you before the next meeting. And I learned a lesson this evening. We will hand deliver materials to the applicant, to the planning board's houses, or mail them to you. That way you will have them shortly after they're submitted.
Madam Chairman, I guess I would ask that all materials be submitted to the town, through the town hall, which then will be distributed hopefully in a timely fashion to the planning board.
I don't want to quarrel with you, Steve, but if we want to mail an extra copy, we will, because I don't want to ever hear again that 15 days went by before a member of the board got the material. I don't want to hear that quarrel, and I don't want to hear it again. We'll make certain it doesn't happen.
Just for the record, I also want to make sure that the applicants don't ever accuse the town staff of perhaps doubling up on information or having materials submitted that are confusing to both the board and the applicant's representatives.
Never said it.
So we should get two of everything from now on, which is better than
that's right.
Zero of everything.
Can't go wrong. And if we read it twice, we'll be so smart.
Madam Chairman,
yes,
and
go ahead.
I'm not quarreling with Mr. Frinsco or the applicant either.
You understand what I'm getting at, Dick?
I understand, but I think it's important to understand that there are two issues. One is application completeness, which is a very formal, very precise process in this town. And then there's technical data, which may or may not be required for the planning board to make a decision to approve, or if it's not received and the board requires it, to potentially deny an application. That will come up throughout.
Of course. No question.
And if there are two areas, you give us a little more hint about what we said tonight, that you want to supply information that we're supposed to request.
Well, I'll tell you. The two areas of discretion are in the community impact analysis. Something that the board and the staff feel would help flesh that out. Any comments from the board would be welcome, since we volunteered it. Any comments on what's there or what could be added before the next meeting would be helpful. Same with the lot by lot. You can require either a high intensity soil analysis, which Daryl Brown, who I think is a respected soil consultant, has certified to you he produced, or you can require a lot by lot analysis using an HHE 200 form for each lot, which was submitted. I'm having trouble finding anything in the ordinance which would tell me what else you would need to meet that standard, but I'm willing to listen to you in order to advance the process.
Madam Chairman, again, if I might, there's a difference between application completeness and
correct.
Technical data being sufficient to approve right. an application. This planning board has had this package for...
Since Friday.
Since Friday of this week. Now, it took me most of the weekend just to fold and unfold drawings.
I'm a non-technical person.
Which I enjoy doing tremendously. But 3 days review of a significant application. You know, I read the community impact study, and I see it. That data is now provided. Whether it's technically appropriate or not, that determination hasn't been made. Won't be made until we really get into the meat of the application.
Understood.
So whether we're requiring more data from what has been submitted, that's not in question tonight. The question is, has it been submitted sufficient for an application completeness? The checklist review suggests that there are areas. The applicant certainly will have that. I'm sure they've taken notes, and I'm sure that we'll provide them that list so that they can see what the planning board has done. There may be other things that have not been completed that we should ask Mr. Hunter whether they're technically it is provided. Mm-hmm. You know, I raised the question about the fill, where there's 4 feet of fill in parts of this road that's been proposed. What are the side slopes, and do those go into the wetlands? That data has not been provided. Does that make complete application or deny a complete application? I don't know. Or is that a technical issue? I mean, those will be determined later. We brought it up tonight. I went through a litany of issues that I saw in the application at the beginning of this whole session that I know that notes are being taken, and I presume that data will be provided to answer some of those questions at least later on. So it's not like we're trying to hide data. It's not like we're trying to not meet our responsibilities. It's really a question of there's one shot to do a completeness letter, and that has to be done appropriately.
Thank
Madam
you.
Chairman?
Yes.
Is there appropriate at this point to move the question on the completeness of this application?
Sure. I think so. We're running 15 minutes
yeah.
over.
I'd like to propose a motion at this point. Be it ordered that the preliminary plan application of the Greater Portland Development Group, Inc. for the Highlands at Broad Cove, a proposed 24-lot subdivision located off Hunts Point Road, Farm Pond Road, Channel View Road, and Two Lights Road, is deemed to be incomplete in accordance with Section 16-2-4 and Appendix B of the subdivision ordinance and the facts presented.
Is there a second?
I've got a problem with that motion, folks.
The board has to reflect on the requirement for a written statement to be given by the applicant within 30 days. And Mr. Frinsco is going to comment on the motion, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm.
Why is it incomplete?
I think the list that we've gone through indicating partial areas is one item. I think we should probably provide to the applicant the minutes detailing the items that Dick mentioned and so many other areas of discussion. but I think that would be one way of defining whether it's incomplete or not.
We're not. I want you to, we're not asking for that decision. I wasn't quarreling with the Tinsman. Mr. Tinsman wants 30 days to make the decision. That's okay with us.
Mr. Fransko, the next time you wish to speak,
I'm sorry,
could you please go through the chair?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
I made a motion. It's been seconded.
Right. Anybody else?
Madam
Any
Chairman.
Comments?
Yes. The alternative to that this evening is to issue a dated receipt and thank the applicant for presenting his preliminary plan and take the 30 days to determine whether the application mm-hmm. is complete, which is what I was suggesting.
Yeah. Okay. Would you be willing to withdraw your motion?
Or vote on it?
I'd be willing to withdraw it. As,
okay.
long as we move the point.
Okay.
Which was the purpose.
Right.
And I have a dated receipt, which is now being duplicated. And I will give that to you.
Okay. Would you like to ask Mr. Brown any questions? You had a question about the wetlands and your own consultation. He's available for you.
Does anyone have any question to ask Mr. Brown at this point? You prefer to wait for the next time.
About the soil?
About the wetlands.
The wetlands. I just think that when we do get to the point of walking them, it would be very helpful to have the flagging explicitly in that. And if you can be there and explain, in addition, that would.
So, you see, you will be leaving with something tonight. I will give you this receipt.
Thank you.
What do you think of that?
I didn't ask for anything.
Thank you very much. Here is the receipt. And I assume we'll see you the next time if you...
Madam Chairman, it may be appropriate to table this pending a determination of completeness. I would so move.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you very much and good luck. Does the planning board need a break before
yes.
the next one? The planning board will take a very short break before we address the next item on the agenda. We'll be back.
Packet, you have a new site plan with the change, and you also have a supposed to have a colored copy of the old one